Good morning, and welcome to the Abraham Lincoln Unitarian Universalist Congregation. My name is Reverend Martin Wolf, and I am the service leader this morning. As you are aware, we have been recording our services and uploading them to our YouTube channel, but we hope that in the near future we might return to in-person services. We, as Unitarian Universalists, honor your mind, your heart, and your journey. We are glad that you are joining us here today. We are people of many paths who are brave, curious, and compassionate thinkers and doers, diverse in age, ethnicity, abilities, gender, economic status, political persuasions, and spirituality. We come together to create a force for good, more powerful than any of us could do alone. We are formally recognized by the Unitarian Universalist Association as a welcoming congregation, which signifies that we celebrate and honor the lives, relationships, and full participation of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender persons, and that these individuals and those individuals who self-identify their gender. We have different beliefs, but we share a constellation of values drawn from many sources. What unites us are seven core principles, which can be found on our website, www.aluuc.org. We have two announcements this morning. The first is a reminder that our Change for Change collection during the month of February will benefit the Animal Protection League, and that there are details that can be found on our website if you would like to donate to this wonderful cause. Secondly, we have an announcement regarding an upcoming adult religious education offering. Members and friends are invited to sign up for a new adult religious education course on world religions, which will start on March the 7th at 7 o'clock via Zoom. On that first date, again, March 7th, Rabbi Barry Marks will speak about Judaism. Future presentations will focus on Buddhism, Hinduism, Christianity, and the sacred feminine. Attendees may attend one or more sessions. If you are interested in this offering, please contact Dee Evans, our intern minister, via email, and you can register that way.
It is our custom in the Unitarian Universalist tradition to light a chalice at the start of our service. By doing so, we declare this time to be a time of significance, a sacred time together. If you have a chalice or a candle at home, we invite you to light it. Now for the words of Reverend Betts Weinecke. May this flame, symbol of transformation since time began, fire our curiosity, strengthen our wills, and sustain our courage as we seek what is good within and around us.
opening words are written by John Gilbert Millspaugh. The title is, "All Too Often, We Pace the Geometries of Our Walled Gardens." All too often, we pace the geometries of our walled gardens, believing we are traversing the whole of creation. With spirits of discovery, let us uncover the mysteries nested in our routines. With the eagerness of children, let us seek out the secrets unfolding in our peripheral vision. Let us behold each fellow creature with reverence. Let us greet each day with praise and thanksgiving. For life is a gift of incomprehensible magnitude. Our lives are voyages with unknowable destinations. Along the way, let us meet, challenge, and support one another. Let us fashion a network of mutuality and extend it into the larger world. In these ways, we forge lives of goodness and beauty. In these ways, we know the life of prayer.
Today we are going to do a brief insight meditation. If you were to think about the word transformation, what does that mean to you personally? And what does it mean in regard to our congregation? Think about this now and carry it forward into the week.
Today's reading is called Litany for Becoming, by and fleshed. To become is a lifelong process. Nothing is constant, not even the self. We evolve in the midst of narratives meant only for some, and ways of being made narrow by fear and power. We must then have the courage to listen to the truth of our own lives, to the wisdom that comes from within, responding without resistance or need to control, but with welcome and curiosity. This is what ensures our becoming is an unfolding of our truest self. This lifelong labor cannot be carried out alone. It requires help from friends and lovers, family and creaturely companions who bear witness to what makes us come alive and say to us, listen, look, feel, pay attention to that. This is loving and being loved. Telling the stories, sharing in the memories, giving thanks for the relationships, understandings, and experiences past that have shaped us to this day. This is loving and being loved. Celebrating new beginnings that excite, holding risks together, leaning into unknowns with the promises of support and companionship. This is loving and being loved. Listening to the future calling uniquely to each of us in the midst of all of life's noise. Helping one another find our place in the shared labor of collective life. Supporting each other in what is the world's ache and what is asking from us. This is loving and being loved. To say for the first time, this is who I am. This is the truth of my body. This is what I know about myself. This is my name, and this is where my path is leading me. And to have it heard, have it received, have it affirmed, and then to say it again and again as we change and as the world changes, and to have each proclamation greeted with an open-armed embrace. This is loving and being loved. There is no me without you. We shape one another. The sacred that birthed us weaves our lives together so that we can only find ourselves through shared becoming. For my journey and all its winding ways, for yours, for all the saints who labored for what is, all the kin whose lives made ours possible, for all those yet to come for whom living our truths today will mean breaking possibilities open for them tomorrow. We pause, we give thanks, we acknowledge. This is loving and being loved.
Good morning. My name is Bonnie Ettinger, and I'm a longtime member of this congregation and a member of the board of directors. I have been asked to introduce our topic today, which is the report Widening the Circle of Concern, which was issued by the UUA Commission on Institutional Change. I was one of many in our congregation who accepted the sabbatical minister Amy Brooks' invitation to read and discuss Widening the Circle of Concern. She coordinated our study with UU congregations in our area, Bloomington, Urbana, Decatur, and Peoria. While we studied chapters within our own congregation on a regular basis, we joined with the others monthly, which I found really interesting to meet these people that are in our region. As the report recommended, a study, action, and advocacy effort must be understood as a ministry. It's a ministry effort related to holistically to the entire faith community. Congregants are encouraged to read it in its entirety, and it's available for free online if you go to Widening the Circle. It's also available as a PDF file if you wish to download it in print. The report says that Sunday worship can be used to invite guided, deep exploration into why our congregation wishes to be actively involved in the changes recommended by the commission, raising questions such as, what is the history of communities of color within our city and state? What role has our community or congregation played in that history? What are predominant attitudes toward the work of widening the circle within our community or congregation? The following is an introduction to the report that describes its purpose and importance much better than I can. Quote, widening the circle of concern, report of the UUA Commission on Institutional Change, must not be viewed as simply an academic exploration into the current state of the prevalence of white supremacy culture within Unitarian Universalism. A mere sociological interest in the Commission on Institutional Change's findings would be an insult to the commissioners' hundreds of dedicated hours of work and would treat as entertainment the re-traumatization of those who gave painful testimony. Instead, as a people of faith, Unitarian Universalists must approach this report with the humility and resolve of a Truth and Reconciliation Council. We must understand that, as a living tradition, our faith's survival depends on its relevance, and relevance depends on accepting and addressing the truth of the findings of the Commission. To fully accept this truth with integrity requires action at every level of our movement and of our congregation. The report focuses on several aspects of our congregational activity: trends, theology, governance, congregation and community, hospitality and inclusion, living our values, religious professionals, educating for liberation, innovations and risk-taking, restoration and reparations, accountability and resources. The speakers that will be following me have chosen a few of those chapters to focus on, and I would like them to start their presentations now.
Hi, my name is Gwen Childs, and I'd like to share some thoughts on innovations and risk-taking. I am currently serving our congregation as president. 2 years ago, before COVID-19 reared its head, we had such high hopes and expectations for the expansion of our facility and how that could accommodate many projects inside and outside our community. However, for the past 2 years, our board has spent much of our time consulting the UUA and many public health sources, advice which was often very confusing, and we were searching for ways that we could be together, both virtually and in person, always putting the safety of the congregation first. Even in normal times, inclusion poses challenges, but the coronavirus and its variants have prompted us to adapt. Zoom meetings have enabled us to keep covenant groups and study circles going, and we are continuing our study of this Widening the Circle report as we prepare for better days in the future. We have invested in equipment to make live streaming our services possible soon, we hope, with recognition that this is a more inclusive option for members who may be unable to attend due to illness, disabilities, or distance, pandemic or not. We've made great progress in honoring many different faith traditions and beliefs, but we know that more needs to be done if we are to become the vibrant, diverse congregation we aspire to be. As you know, Unitarian Universalism has its roots in white Anglo-Saxon Protestant tradition, and we may need to take a look at this. Speaking personally, I grew up in the Methodist Church. Their Sunday service was structured in a very similar way, except that when Methodists sing their beloved old hymns, they break out into four parts. That was the best part of the service for me. And as a result, I love those old hymns and traditional customs because of my childhood experiences. But sometimes I wonder how Jewish people feel when they visit for the first time. It must feel very strange to them. How do Native Americans, or Buddhists, or Hindus, or those who grew up in a traditional Catholic faith feel when they come in? Do African Americans feel comfortable with us, or do they long to sing their old spirituals rather than our old Anglo-Saxon hymns? We don't show much overt emotion in our services, and our minister rarely raises his voice. So do people from evangelical backgrounds think we're too cold? Do atheists and humanists squirm when we make religious references? How do people who have not been raised in any faith feel? I realize that it's impossible to be all things to all people, but do we try hard enough to discover what feeds their spirits? To create a beloved community, we must be open to innovations and risk-taking. This will mean we have to get out of our comfort zones. It will involve being more sensitive to those who feel marginalized, to those who may not have a college degree or an impressive job, to those who have responsibilities or disabilities that make it difficult for them to participate in certain activities, to those who have financial worries, to those who are being harmed by discrimination, and so forth. We need to look for creative ways to increase our diversity in our congregation and in our leadership positions. One suggestion is to look at giving financial support to those who could benefit from attendance at a General Assembly or UU District workshop, but who can't afford the cost. This would give us much more diversity in our leadership positions. There are many other interesting ideas to explore in the Widening the Circle of Concern report. Our congregation has traditionally done well in several areas, so we have a good base to work from. For instance, we are a welcoming congregation and have many LGBTQ people serving in leadership roles. We have shown a dedication to accessibility at our facility, most recently adding an all-gender ADA restroom. And I am very pleased that our congregation has already started building relationships with Calvary Missionary Baptist Church. The pandemic has slowed us down a bit, but when we can have more face-to-face meetings, we will deepen those relationships. I still enjoy the friendships I made in the Hartford UU Alliance with Bethel AME. This is the type of experience that enriched my life and will enrich more lives in the future here. Speaking of this, there is an excellent PBS video that you can stream right now. It is called Finding Fellowship. That's a PBS video that's free for you. It's about two white Methodist churches and a black Methodist church who are comprised of descendants of slaves and slave owners. And they decided to merge right about around the time that Martin Luther King was assassinated. It's a fascinating story and well worth watching. As a member of an interracial family, stories like this give me hope that reconciliation is possible. All of us realize that the world is changing at an astonishing pace. People come to houses of worship for sustenance, and we need to offer comfort, encouragement, and a sense of belonging. I encourage our congregation to learn more about ways to adapt, because everything must change. And we need to be a part of creating a better world for our children to inherit.
Hi, my name is Anna Sabin, and I am a member of this congregation. I also am the chair of the membership committee and serve on our board of directors. As part of my role with the membership committee, this is a conversation that we've had for a while, which is to try to touch base with all of the members of our congregation in an attempt to try to figure out where we're at and what abilities members of our congregation have to be able to help contribute to specifically the work that Widening Our Circle encourages us to do. So the idea is that we want to try to get outside of our comfort zones, make change, and try to improve our congregation as a whole. As part of that, we are going to start and get the ball rolling by putting out a survey for our congregation members to complete. The idea of this survey, you'll be seeing it in March. And the idea of this survey is to collect information not only about who the members and friends of our congregation are, but what are the talents and experiences that you are able to offer and bring to our congregation and share with us as we do this work of widening the circle and trying to improve our role and where we stand in not only our congregation, but in our community as a whole. So, just wanted to give this as sort of an announcement for everybody to be aware. You will be getting an email. We'll start by emailing it out and you can complete it online, but there will be more information coming in the coming months and you may be contacted either by phone or by postcard from members of our congregation to try to help you fill it out. Thank you.
First of all, we need to understand that widening the circle of concern is about a lot of things. It's about paying attention to who we include and who we exclude. It's about holding up a mirror and taking a good hard look at ourselves and deciding if that's who we really want to be. It's about reminding ourselves of what our ideals are and kind of self-checking ourselves to see if we're living up to those ideals. In RE, we used the Widening the Circle report as a springboard, and it pushed us into hard discussions. We had to ask ourselves, so all right, we're engaging in faith formation with our youth and children. What are we including? What are we leaving out? And who are we affecting when we make those decisions? And so, when we're taking a look at what we're offering our youth and children in terms of their faith formation, we had to ask ourselves, is the curriculum we're using doing what we need it to do? Is it meeting the youth and children where they are, and is it responsive to their needs? In some cases it was, and in other cases it wasn't. And you've seen some changes in the RE program over the last few years because of the answers that we came to. One of the first things we did was take a look at the Youth and Child Library. These are books that are used in the classrooms, but are also available for youth and children to check out. And we found that we didn't have as wide a diversity of texts on our shelves as we wanted to. We wanted to be more inclusive, so we deliberately sought out texts that expanded the circle of people that we had represented on our shelves, and we're pretty happy with the result. Ironically, it was COVID that pushed us to explore the diversity that we had in our RE volunteer pool. We had some folks step back during COVID, and as we planned to return to in-person, we looked at our program and asked ourselves, well, what do we look like as a volunteer pool? We were largely white, female, middle-aged, cisgendered, and able-bodied. We realized that this does not reflect either our congregation nor our community, and so we engaged in some both and thinking. We certainly wanted to preserve the volunteers we did have, but we did not want to discourage anyone from volunteering because they didn't look like the volunteers we currently had. So we widened the circle, and we deliberately invited folks who didn't look like a typical RE volunteer. As a result, we ended up with more men teaching, with more people who are LGBTQ, more people who are diversely abled, and more people who did not stay within the confines of middle age. COVID also forced us to ask if the program as a whole was meeting the needs of our youth and children, especially as we came back for the first time to in-person after COVID. Our youth and children came back with varying degrees of trauma, as did our adults. Accordingly, we decided that simply teaching content wasn't going to be enough. Well, honestly, is it ever if you're a Unitarian Universalist? We also needed to teach habits and tools that would enable our youth and children to rebuild or maybe even initially forge connections that they had been missing over the last year. And so every lesson that we teach has a social-emotional learning component attached to it, so that youth actually get the skills and capacities they need to re-engage with others. We've also begun experimenting with a restorative justice approach to conflict between and among youth. This is an approach that doesn't seek to blame so much as it seeks to resolve the harm and reunite the community once there has been a conflict between two people. If you'd like to know more about this, please feel free to stop by and ask me. I'd be delighted to tell you about it. So, that's how the Widening the Circle report has affected us here in RE. It's kind of a boots-on-the-ground approach, and we've really appreciated the difference that it's made in our ability to serve our youth.
All right. My name is Sarah Thomas, and I attended the Widening the Circle discussion groups as a member of the ALUUC. I wanted to share my experience with the report and why I feel it's important and worthwhile. To me, the discussions broadened my thinking and sparked intense reflection, most notably on reparations. And going into this, when I thought of reparations, I thought money. And I didn't, from what I could observe, our congregation didn't have money or money to give, even if we wanted to. But by reading the work and discussing with our congregation and others, I read the information on the subject. It was one that I still struggled to understand, but taking it all in and having more discussions, I found that it goes beyond literal reparations, beyond money or returning land. It's about changing our mindsets and acknowledging past wrongs and going forward and making it right. Acknowledging it by putting systems into place and efforts and in publicizing our efforts or within our group to make it right. It is not about simply posting a job and hoping someone of color applies. It's about looking at our systems or how we can level the playing field. Previous speakers talked about money to go to national events, talking about covenant groups, how we can go forward and right the past wrongs. By using our existing anti-racist and racial justice work, we have a good framework to go forward. We as a congregation are open to new ideas. By looking at the past, it can guide us forward. This work embodies the best of our intentions and actions as a congregation and community.
We'll have our first meeting on Thursday, March the 3rd at 7 p.m. via Zoom. We invite all of you to join us in starting this new exciting project. Please feel free to email any of the people you have seen speak today for more information. For today's closing words, a short piece by Rainer Rilke called Try to Love the Questions Themselves. Have patience with everything unresolved in your heart, and try to love the questions themselves as if they were locked rooms or books written in a very foreign language. Don't search for the answers, which could not be given to you now, because you would not be able to live them. And the point is to live everything. Live the questions now. Perhaps then, someday, far in the future, you will gradually, without even noticing it, live your way into the answer.
As our time here comes to a close, we invite you to extinguish your candle or chalice. In our tradition, we offer these words to conclude our service. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts always.